שלום לכולם שוב. בספר משלי, שבו. בספר משלי, פרק כ"ב, פסוק ו', נכתב פסוק שאולי הוא מדויק כמו הציטוט שאבי ציטט ממרק טוויין. נכתב פסוק שכולנו מפיצים אותו במאמרים ובפוסטים שלנו, והוא, מי יודע? לא משהו, אה? לורד ג'ים צדק בית ספר פשט את הרגל. משלי כף בית, פרק ו', חנוך לנער על פי דרכו. חנוך לנער על פי דרכו זה משפט שאנחנו משתמשים בו, הוא יהיה גם התמה שעומדת מאחורי הפאנל הבא. כולנו משתמשים בו כדי להגיד מה שבתעשייה קוראים customized ו-adaptive, וכל המילים האלה, ה-personalized, כן? אז אנחנו המצאנו את זה קודם. אמר לי לפני כמה שנים רב, שכבר לא איתנו, חיתן את נכדתו ואת נינו, לא מזמן, שאנחנו, החילונים, לא מבינים את הפסוק הזה נכון. חנוך לנער על פי דרכו, מה שאנחנו חושבים, זה לא זה. חנוך בא מלשון חניכיים, חנוכה, מלשון לתכנת. והפסוק אומר, צריך לתכנת את הילד על פי דרכו, כמו על פי הבהר, לפני שהוא מתחיל את הדרך שלו. תתכנתו את הילד לפני שהוא מתחיל את הדרך שלו. ואיך אני יודע שזו המשמעות הנכונה של הפסוק, אומר אותו הרב? משום שהמשך הפסוק הוא חנוך לנער על פי דרכו, גם אם יזקין, לא יסור ממנה. גם כשהוא יהיה זקן, הוא לא יסור מהדרך. בקיצור, פרשנות. יש לנו בעיה עם הפסוק. מי יוכל לענות לנו יותר טוב מאשר הפאנל הבא שלנו? מי שתנחה אותו, ואני אציג אותה כעת, היא פרופסור קרין נהון. רציתם לשאול שאלה בשלב הזה, נכון? אז אני יכול להציג אותה, אבל אתם רוצים, המארגנים רצו לשאול אתכם שאלה. אוקיי. אתם צריכים לחשוב, אתם זוכרים את התרגיל, לחשוב במהלך הפאנל על השאלה הזאת. זאת שאלת what if, מה אילו? מה היה קורה אם לתלמידה היה עוזר אישי ממוחשב? In Hebrew it's gender sensitive. שמבין אותה, מסונכרן עם היומן שלה, מכיר את הטעם האישי שלה ויודע את כל התוכן הלימודי של בית הספר, מין סירי כזה, חכם. מה נלמד בבית הספר בתרחיש שכזה? עכשיו, אתם לא צריכים רק לחשוב על התשובות לשאלה הזו. אם ילחצו עוד פעם על הכפתור, אלה שלוחצים על הכפתורים, הופ, אתם רואים, תסתכלו פה טוב, תזכרו בעל פה, יש לכם 20 שניות, כמו שמרטין אמר, להעביר את המידע הזה לזיכרון הקבוע שלכם, זה מה שנקרא למידה, ושם תוכלו לענות, אחר כך נעשה מזה שמחה והילולה, אז תענו ברצינות. פרופסור קרין נהון, she's a virologist. Her book, Going Viral from 2013, is something that you should not skip. She is president of the Israel Internet Association, and she's an associate professor both at IDC, the Israel Disciplinary Center at Herzliya, and the University of Washington. And most importantly, she represents Israel at the UN, at the Committee for Science and Technology. And as we heard about the UN, there's a new sheriff in town. Karine.
Good morning, everyone. Just to make a clarification, I'm not a virologist. I deal with virality of information, but definitely not virologist in the sense of biology and all this stuff. Good morning, everyone, and it's an honor to be here at the EdTech Summit. And it's amazing, I've been here in the first year, and it was around 200, 300 people, and now suddenly it's 1,000 people. That's amazing. We have an amazing panel of four marvelous, great people that are going to come on stage in a second. And let me introduce you first to the speakers, and then I'll ask them to come up on stage. We have keynotes of two out of those speakers, and then we'll open it for a panel. The panel deals with artificial intelligence and how machines actually enable schooling to learning. We'll be talking a little bit about the values of artificial intelligence, but at the same time, we'll talk about the challenges of those tools. So I will start by introducing Professor Rose Luckin, a professor of Learning Center Design at UCL Knowledge Lab at the UK. Rose's research involves the design and evaluation of education technology using theories from the learning sciences and techniques from artificial intelligence. She works closely with education technology industry, in particular startups and SME, small enterprises. Rose has advised research councils in various countries and has written widely about education technologies, and she has taught schools, and she's the governor and trustee at the St. Paul Schools in London. So welcome, Professor Luckin. And the second person that I would like to invite to the stage is Professor David Weinberger. David, please. David writes about the effects of the internet on our ideas, has a background in philosophy, a PhD from University of Toronto. And Professor Weinberger is a senior researcher at the Berkman Klein Center at Harvard for Internet and Society. And for almost 5 years, he co-directed the Library Innovation Lab, which oversees a set of creative developers and initiating the managing of library cloud. So thank you for joining us, Professor Weinberger. And we have two other speakers. I would like to invite to the stage Professor Jihad El-Sana, if you can come to the stage, from Ben Gurion University. Professor Jihad El-Sana is affiliated with the Department of Computer Science in Ben Gurion University in the Negev. And he received his bachelor degree and master degree in computer science in Ben Gurion and won the Fulbright Scholarship for doctoral studies. His research deals with image processing, augmented reality, computational geometry, and document image analysis. And he heads the department Visual Media Lab. So welcome, Professor Sana. And finally, we have David Konopnicki. Welcome, from IBM. David manages the information retrieval group at the Haifa Research Lab at IBM. He deals mainly, has been involved with unstructured content and has been leading a variety of projects which mainly develops at large-scale full-text search engines and building customer profiles. Okay, so now that I've finished finally with my dues, I can really talk to you guys. So we will start, before I will introduce the panel, actually I will start with the two speakers and then I will make a more introduction to the panel. So I would like to introduce for Professor Luckin, who will talk for 12 minutes about the values of artificial intelligence in education. So Professor Luckin.
Can you hear me? Yes, is the mic working?
Yes, it is. Okay. Thank you very much, and it's lovely to be here. I'm going to start off by telling you a story, because I want to bust a couple of myths, and then I want to tell you a couple of ways in which AI can help us improve education. So I'm going to start with this story, which is about somebody called Joe, who spent a few years living in China in the city of Nanjing, which is the silk capital of China. But he's really struggled to learn Mandarin, and he can't communicate with his neighbors, which he finds very upsetting because he's a social kind of a guy. One of his neighbors, Wu, decides that he needs to help Joe. So he introduces him to Professor Chan at Nanjing University. And Professor Chan has been studying intelligence and language learning for a number of years, and he's developed a new special language learning room. So Joe enters the language learning room. And this language learning room is sealed, there's no windows, but there is a slot in one side of the room and a slot in the other side of the room. So Jay sits in this room, and there's a big rule book in front of him, and he receives through the left-hand slot Chinese symbols, and he looks in the rule book, and he converts the Chinese symbol into an English symbol and passes it out the other side. Now, Joe's in this room for a month. You know, they feed him, they look after him, they give him a few comfort breaks, but he's in there for a month. And after a month, Professor Chan opens the door, welcomes him out, and rewards him with a beautiful book written in Mandarin and waits for Joe to read. Joe can't read a word. Because, of course, Joe doesn't understand Chinese. He can obey the rules, he can convert the characters, but he doesn't understand Chinese. AI doesn't understand what it computes either. It doesn't matter whether it's a rule-based system, a statistical-based system, or a deep neural network. The AI has no self-knowledge, no metacognitive awareness. It does not understand. That's myth one. Myth two, when I say AI, what do you think about? You probably think about some sort of technology. Maybe it's a Siri, maybe it's a robot, but it's probably a technology. Technology is not AI. Technology is the least important part of AI. The most important part of AI is design. It's working out what the problem is that you want to solve, breaking it down, working out what the solution might be, and then deciding what role AI should have. Then comes the technology, because you choose the best technology to suit the purpose. So if we take into account that unlike human beings, AI does not understand what it knows and has no metacognitive ability, humans do, very important thing to remember, humans do, AI doesn't, then what on earth is the possibility of an AI replacing a teacher? It's not going to happen. Can you imagine an AI trying to explain to a parent why it has given a particular grade, trying to justify exactly what has gone on, let alone having all the capacity to understand the emotions and the motivations and everything that's going on for the learners, the whole of their well-being? It's not going to happen. So it's not a case of AI replacing teachers. So what is it? Well, one of the key things about being a good teacher is understanding that all learners are different. They all see things differently and want to learn in different ways and need different sorts of support. So what we need to do is understand the learners. So AI can't understand itself, but maybe it can help us to understand learners and what is happening for learners. So what is AI good for when it comes to education? AI, in combination with big data and smart visualization techniques, can help us to take on some of the biggest challenges in education. I mean the challenges such as the inequality in many education systems, whereby the most privileged can afford the tutors, can afford the best schools, therefore can pass the exams, therefore get on in society. I mean the achievement gaps between those who can shine in the way that we choose to assess them and those who don't get a chance to show us the brilliance that they have inside them. That's where AI can help. One of the other tough problems in education at the moment is the shortage of teachers. I think the latest estimate is something like 69 million by 2030, merely to deliver primary and secondary education globally. That's a lot of teachers that we don't have. So if I'm saying AI can't replace teachers, how can we tackle that teacher shortage intelligently with AI? Okay, so let's start with the first part of that. So part of the reason that the system is unfair is because we only assess students on a very narrow part of what it is that they need to learn and understand. We tend to assess them through exams and tests, sometimes other ways, but mainly in that way still, on their knowledge of particular subjects. And that doesn't suit everyone. If we use the kinds of data that we can now collect, we can collect social networking data, we can collect TV surveillance data, we can collect data about how a student has used their identity card to get into the library, to buy lunch, to buy books in the bookshop. We can use, of course, the data that we can collect when they're interacting with technology, but it's not just that data that we can collect. We can collect a whole host of things about what's going on. That if we use AI smartly to process by identifying the key questions that we need to answer through that data, because we know what it is we're looking for in terms of what we believe signifies learning and progress, then we can start to really unlock the black box of learning. We can start to shine a light, yes, on all of those sorts of knowledge that those who are in favor of standardized assessment want us to be able to acknowledge. We can look at whether they're good at math or history. But we can also look at how, over time, each learner deals with challenges. Are they resilient? Can they learn from the things that have challenged them? We can use the visualization of this data, this kind of thing here is a very simple visualization, to help students understand themselves, to help them discuss with their teachers and parents where they're doing well and where they need help. And most importantly, we can help learners to be more effective learners, because it's that self-learning ability that's going to be a key skill in the workforce of the future, not the routine cognitive skills and knowledge that we seem obsessed with testing at the moment. And this picture over here is a way of assessing collaborative problem solving. So we can really start to use AI to assess the sorts of things that we're just not assessing at the moment. So it can help us to shine a light on the skills and abilities of many students, and it can help us to stop the privileged always getting the best exam results and moving forward in society. It can help us to identify and value lots of different sorts of skills, abilities, and characteristics. So that's number one. This might be the result. Exam systems are definitely unfair. We could get rid of all stop and test exams, and imagine how, if we did that, we would unleash innovation in the education system. We can certainly do that. But now on to teacher shortages. So I've said we can't replace teachers with AI, so what can we do? Okay, we need more human teachers. That's the nub of the issue here. So how do we get more human teachers into teaching? Well, we're working with a small company in London called Third Space Learning, who are linking up learners with online human tutors in different parts of the world. And these online learning sessions are done through audio and shared whiteboard, no video, so it's suitable for young learners as well as older learners. So it's human tutoring, the highest quality, one-to-one human tutoring. So where can AI help in this? Well, for this business, one of the key blockers to their scaling up and enabling everybody to benefit from this one-to-one tutoring is the fact that they have to be able to guarantee high-quality learning sessions, which means they evaluate all of their tutors at least once a week. That's a lot of human evaluators in a business to make sure that they can guarantee high-quality tutoring. So what we're helping them to do is to use AI to identify, rather, we're using our knowledge of intelligence to identify the signifiers of good online tutoring sessions, and then we're designing algorithms to recognize these so that we can automate the assessment of the tutors, so we can have more people gaining the benefit of one-to-one human tutoring without having to have lots of human evaluators. And hey, those human evaluators aren't out of a job because they can become online tutors too. Anybody throughout the world with the right kind of skills and knowledge can tutor for an hour a week, 2 hours a week, 3 hours a week. So it really starts to enable us to get high-quality human tutoring to lots of people by using AI smartly, not to replace the tutor, but to replace the evaluator. So this is the way in which we can tackle one of those other big educational problems. So I said I'd try and bust a couple of myths about AI being technology and about it being intelligent in the understanding sense, and therefore about the possibility of replacing teachers. And I said I'd give you a couple of examples of how we use AI to tackle big education problems, achievement gaps, inequality, teacher shortages. But it's not by trying to design an AI complete system. It's about working out the right blend of human and artificial intelligence. It's about designing AI assistants and assistants, not robot tutors. It's about forging partnerships to scale and bring AI benefits to everybody, especially the disadvantaged. And it's about hybrid AI techniques being used to ensure that we have the right kind of AI in the right place to solve the big problems in education. And I'm going to stop there. Thank you very much.
Our next speaker is Professor David Weinberger. David, please.
It's an honor and a pleasure to be here. So I want to find the clicker. I want to talk about what I think may be, in the long term, an epical change in how we think and how we think about thinking, and which is brought about by the very alien way in which computers think. And after Rose's presentation, I want to be certain to put in computers think in quotation marks, because I completely agree with you, so, and knowledge as well. So humans, when we ask somebody, ask a human being, how do you draw an eight, she will either just draw it for you, or she'll say, it's two circles, stacked circles vertically. If you are a machine, if you are a computer, and you are a program to do machine learning, that's not at all how you think about a figure eight. Instead, humans will select some thousands of examples of the numeral eight written by different people, different penmanship, and you as a computer will analyze it into each one into basically a grid of gray scales, each one of which is a number, because you're a computer, you don't know about gray, but you know about numbers. You don't know about numbers, but I don't even know what to say. You can deal with numbers or the representation of binary digits. So you'll do that, and you will compare and come up with some probabilities for, well, I guess if this pattern, so this is a matrix of numbers, this, you give it a new matrix of numbers, and it will assign a probability based upon the other things that it's looked at to say, yes, this is probably an eight. It's not at all the way that we think, but it actually turns out to be, you know, computers can recognize a lot of different sorts of eights. If you take a variation of machine learning called deep learning, it gets more mysterious. So the standard example of deep learning is AlphaGo, which was created by Google and which is currently beating the world's greatest human players of the game Go, which is an immensely complex game. And roughly the way that it works, and I'm going to be rough about it because that's as good as I can be. First of all, you set up a simulated, you simulate the human brain, a neural network, except it's a digital sort of representation of it. And in this case, Google fed it 130,000 games of Go and 30 million different moves. And it just like the figure eight, it looks at the moves and tries to find in this matrix of numbers some patterns. But the way that it works is, especially with neural networks or hierarchical neural networks, is you pass the data through, it comes out with some conclusions, so to speak. You pass them through again, you keep doing this, and you end up with this immense network of nodes. And each of these nodes is connected to other nodes with some assigned weight, some probability that, like a neuron, it will fire or it won't. This is the roughest conceivable explanation, and I am not a computer scientist, so I expect to be corrected at any moment. I can see. So you do that, and it gives you the next move. It says, okay, well, then this is the next move. And let's say you say, well, that seems weird, AlphaGo. That seems totally wrong. Why did you tell me to do that? That's what came out of the room with the Chinese reading room, so to speak. Why that move? And AlphaGo very likely simply cannot tell you. Or more exactly, it will say, Okay, I'll explain it to you, pitiful human being. So here's the explanation. Let's look at node 1. Node 1 connects to these other nodes with these other probabilities. You got that? Okay, let's look at node 2. It connects here and here and here with these probabilities. And let's keep going until we get to a billion nodes, and then you'll understand. Because that's how it made its decision. We can't do that. That's meaningless to us. If we got all those numbers, we would then, the only way we could figure out what that means for making the next move is to feed it back into a computer and have the computer do the calculation, which is where we started. We cannot this is an alien way of thinking. We cannot understand how it's thinking. And with deep learning, that is at least frequently the case. So how do we know that it's thinking right? Well, in AlphaGo, it's easy, because it keeps beating us. It wins. And this sort of thinking is immensely powerful. It is awesomely powerful. It lets us address problems we simply couldn't before. But a lot of people are nervous about it, which I understand, because we have systems that are going to be guiding our autonomous cars, our self-driving cars, and they're going to make decisions like, okay, we're going to have to slam your car, into the side of the road because that's the best outcome. And you say, why? And it says, well, let's start with node 1. Node 1 is going to, and it's troubling that we have machines that are making moral decisions, or decisions that have moral consequences, in ways that we cannot question and interrogate, at least not in every case. I'm not going to talk about that. It's a really interesting field, obviously. I don't want to talk about it at all. I want to talk about whether the extent to which this is a weirdly other model than the one that we've had for how we think thinking works and how we think the universe works. So for the past few hundred years, at least, we have accepted, and properly so, a Newtonian model, which says that there are universal laws, which was new with Newton. The same laws apply everywhere, and they're very simple. I mean, they're hard for someone like me, but they're simple enough that human beings can understand them. And what a surprise, the laws of the universe turn out to be entirely knowable by humans, which is a tremendous coincidence. Who would have thought that the universe, which is very complex, it works out, it is exactly right for humans. So universal, simple, and knowable laws. That allows us to make models of how the universe works. That is a set of laws that we can plug data into and get results. We can represent those as a physical thing if we want, but for Newton, of course, they were numerical. They're mathematical models. I am not arguing against Newton, okay? Newton's okay, he doesn't need me to defend him. But I do want to ask, I at least want to point out the difference between a Newtonian model, simple universal laws, and this deep learning model, where it's all particulars connected infinite, near infinite, whatever that means, gigantic arrays. This is a very different way of thinking. We can ask, well, which is better, which is right? Well, clearly the Newtonian model works, but it only works because we ignore all the places that it doesn't work. Again, I'm not criticizing Newton, but we take this model and we use it and we just sort of ignore the probably most common occurrence, which is that we make a prediction based upon a Newtonian model in everyday life, and the ball that we expect to go this way doesn't because it hits a bad bounce because there happens to be a pebble in the field. Life is very contingent. We ignore the inaccuracy. That is, we can predict where the billiard ball is going to go and we line up the shot, and we're probably right, but we're not exactly right. We're getting it approximately right, because if you wanted to get it exactly right, you'd have to worry about the nap, the felt, the exact threads, and the quantum forces, and the effect of the gravity of the moon on the path of the billiard ball, because it has some little effect. If you really wanted to know, you'd have to calculate that in. And when somebody draws in their breath at the shot, goes, that affects it as well. That's affecting the air in the room. So we accept it because it works for the goals that we want, but in real life, it's always inaccurate, at least to some degree. And traditionally, we have given up on applying these laws to areas that are just too complex. But that's okay. We just recognize the path of smoke. Yeah, it's just too complex. Human consciousness, human behavior, free will, those sorts of things. Yeah, it's just too complex. So it works because it works for the things that we want it to work for, but we also are happy to ignore the places where it doesn't, which is fine. We've been tethered to, our expectations have been shaped by our technology, and our technology until recently was epitomized by computers that were incredibly slow and could handle extremely little data. At one point, fed in on punch cards. But now, of course, everything is a sensor. The things that we all carry around in our pockets are sensors emitting tons of data. There's sensors across the world and orbiting the Earth. Everything is a sensor, enormous amounts of data, enormous network, enormous high-speed computers that are joined together as a distributed computing network beyond our imagination even from a couple of years ago. And that, I think, changes some of the equation. So if we want to ask about the alien intelligence, I think we have to balance the Newtonian sort of view that there are universal, simple laws that are knowable by humans with the view that we are now encountering in our deep learning machines, which is that there is way too much data for a human brain and the relationships are way too complex. Now we can deal with this data. We can do it in real time. We can handle far more interrelationships. And we can also deal with the fact that in some practical sense, everything, if you look at anything closely enough, everything is an exception. So if you want to know where the alien intelligence is, I'm going to suggest, at least for today, that human intelligence is more alien than the computer one. That at this point, deep learning is gives us a more accurate representation of how the world works. That we have shaved off the details in our pursuit of universality and laws that we can apply top down. So what does this mean for education? I have no idea. First thing that maybe it means, and this is long term, is that, well, maybe there won't be quite so much emphasis on students showing their work, because we are going to get more and more used to the idea that knowledge is something that we co-create with computers. We're already pretty well used to that. In truth, we've been co-creating with instruments, with things in the world, since the first time a shepherd carved a notch in a stick to count the sheep. So this is an old idea. The extended mind model talks about this a great deal. Second of all, we have often tried to teach by providing universal theories, high-level abstractions, and let students apply them, as if that's where the truth is. And of course, there is truth in those abstractions, but they are also, they tend to, as I say, file away, sand down the particulars and the exceptions. So if you want to learn a programming language, you can take a course online or in a classroom and get the general principles and work your way down. That'll work. We've taught a lot of people that way. But far more likely these days is you'll go online, you'll start a tutorial, you'll get one chapter in, you'll start doing some work, you'll hit, how do I do this or that, and you'll go out and you will ask at any of the really excellent sites like Stack Overflow, and addressing very particular problems as they arise. And you can become a very good computer programmer that way. And the last thing I want to suggest, and it's just that, is that maybe what we are going to see is a return of the humanities as our as a model of knowledge, of what knowledge is, for this reason, that humanities love complexity. Literature, history, love the complex. Art loves complexity. It loves unpredictability. Each of these, if history was predictable, it would not be very interesting. Neither would life be. If literature was predictable, it wouldn't be interesting. Humanities love unpredictability. They love exceptions. They love making things out of exceptions. They love finding the exceptions and dealing with the particular in its individuality. Humanities understand, as do the sciences, that everything is interpreted. There is no raw data in humanities. Data is only the given if we take it. And that act of taking is an act of interpretation. The humanities are built around that notion. It also implies, as absolutely science does as well, a deep sense of humility, of the smallness of our capacity in the face of an overwhelmingly particular and exceptional world, and along with the sciences also, therefore, provides the conditions for awe. So that what I'm suggesting is that the model of thinking that we are learning from the success of deep learning may, in fact, change our ideas about what it means to actually think as real human beings. Thanks.
I think I just took your microphone, David.
Oh.
OK, Okay, so thank you for both of you for your talk. I think now it would be very interesting to open a panel which discusses a little bit of the challenges that occurs in some of the big questions that you both of you have raised explicitly and latently, I mean, around the scenes much. I would like to start with David Konopnicki, and if you may, I will use your private name from now on, just because to make it easier until we... David, can you tell us a little bit of, like, 2 minutes to give a briefing about your work at IBM, about your work at AI, and maybe about the challenges that you are facing?
Okay. So hi, yes. So I think in this panel, I'm the technologist. Together with my team in IBM, what we do is that we develop AI systems, usually infrastructures for AI. For example, we develop technology for the next generation of search engines that are able not only to bring you information, but also to converse with you in order to allow you to discover what information is available, how it is structured, how to access it. So for example, imagine that you have a search engine, but you don't know exactly what is there. You know, it's about legal information, but you are not an attorney, you don't understand legal, and you have a question. So the search engine will be able to, you know, to make you discover the information and explain what is there, but also will be able to take the information inside and summarize it, simplify it for you. So this is one type of things that we develop. Another aspect of the thing that we work on is analysis of emotions. So measuring what are the emotions of the user, expressed in text, expressed in speech, expressed through facial expressions. And then we are trying to use this emotional information in order to improve computer systems. And for this type of technologies now, we work with other teams in IBM in order to apply that to different industries, and in particular for education.
So if you had to pinpoint to the big challenges that faces your work, not necessarily technological challenges, maybe.
I think in the continuation of the two talks that we heard, I think that there are maybe two big challenges. One is how to put the information that we have about the users in the hands of the users, how they can control it, how we can show it and explain it. And I think in the two talks, the issue of explainability is very prominent, and this is a problem that we have. As this one explained, when we are developing deep learning systems, it is very difficult to take what the system knows about somebody that is really a mathematical model, and then come back to the user and say, okay, this is what we know about you. Do you agree? You know, and or do you want to change it? Right? It's currently, you know, really open research. How do you do that? In some cases you can do it, but in most cases you can't.
Jihad. Your work with the computer vision lab in order to translate, understand Arabic manuscripts. In a way, you are connecting users, you're connecting citizens, Arabic citizens, or people who love the Arabic language with their heritage. So tell us a little bit about this project, and tell us also a little bit about the challenges that faces your project.
Thank you. So we are working in part of, this is part of our work in the lab, which is with image processing. We're also doing a lot of work in augmented reality, and which is also could be connected to this. But one of the things which is we utilize a machine learning, and this is one of the things which is what we call learning from example. What he explains about kind of how the machine learn actually, they don't really learn in the conceptual we know as human. We provide many examples, and these examples, here is example. For example, I'll give you kind of simple things. You will say the word eight. Here is the word eight. You give the computer one example with one shape, and this is eight. Another example. You give millions of examples. And eventually, the concept is very simple. You, the computer have to solve a million by million kind of matrix or something, millions by millions. So the conceptually it's very simple, but the computers have to work hard to get us sometimes days and sometimes weeks to provide really to learn how to recognize this letter. So all the problem to allow the machine to learn more is to provide more examples. Now, if we want the machine to learn or look for a word, it doesn't matter if it's Arabic or Hebrew, whatever language, handwritten, it's not written in text. In text is very simple. But if we want to look for this word in a book, which is scanned as a set of images, it's more complex. We need the machine to learn how this word look like. But this word will look different by one writer and another. Even the same writer will write the same word different, depends on his mood, his kind of, if he's tired or unhappy or whatever. And the idea how we can really locate this very fast. The big problem is how to create large data in order to allow the machines to learn from. So this is one thing. We also would like to the machines to know who wrote this document. But we cannot let the machine determine who is the writer of this document unless we provide the machine with hundreds and thousands of samples of different writers, and it will tell us to which writer, which is the closest writer to the this sample script. This is what we do in document analysis. We also do a work in augmented reality, and the ideas there is more complex. So if Avi is stuck with his car in the middle of the desert and would like to fix it, so the main idea is, can we provide him an interface that he will take his phone, point to the engine of the car, and the computer will tell him, okay, unscrew these screws, take off this hood, do all these measures until you find the problem, then fix. I'll tell you step by step how to put it back. And this is one of the things which is now we are trying to develop. Kind of, it's mainly not for Avi in the desert, but imagine an astronaut in the space station who need to fix something. And instead of running with heavy manuals, they will have it kind of in his helmet. Thank you.
I would like to raise questions to the panel, and feel free to jump in. David, in your talk, you were talking, something came up to my mind when you said that AI eventually is more accurate to explain the world. This is what you said, and you said eventually everything is an exception. Yes, you did say that. I swear to God.
I deny that.
Well, actually, that follows to a little bit of what Rose was saying, is that she would like to see AI as something that mitigates inequalities. Now, here's my challenge to you. I'm a professor myself. I deal with big data myself. We learn big data every day, thousands, millions of records. Which are eventually, they're not really only about how the world works, but when we come to educators, when we come to learners, it's really about how people behave, how people think, how people are aware of things. It's more messy because it's people, right? And my question is about the red lines. We like as researchers or as high-techists to collect data. Data for us is the bread and butter that allows us to eat and flourish. But on the other hand, data is people. Data is a little bit about people. And my question is, two questions. One is, what are the red lines in terms of breaching privacies of people? Because we don't ask them. In many cases, we collect public data. We know what is public data, right? I mean, that's what we do. So the first question is, what are the red lines? And it's a big question, right? And the second question is really going back to both of you, the inequalities, about mitigating the inequalities. When we collect the big data, we collect and we're looking for standards, because this is how the machine learns. It learns by looking at patterns that returns again and again. But if everything is the standard, what is left to the people who think outside of the box? They don't fall in the standard of the millions of people that the machine learn to recognize and continue and behave. So what place do we leave to people that are different? and especially when we're dealing with education, learning. So it's two questions, a little bit heavy questions, but I throw it at the table.
Okay, do you want to go first? Okay, can you hear me? Yeah, you can. So the red lines, I think, is the most important question of all. And one of the reasons that I'm trying to draw attention to what AI can and can't do, and to the fact that actually for it to do something incredibly valuable, we need those huge data sets, is to get that conversation going. Because I'm concerned that people in general don't realize the data that's collected about them and what happens to it. And I'm worried that the way in which that is being abused by certain corporations at the moment will create a negative reaction when we try and do these things for good. So I think the key question is the hearts and minds one. What is it that people want from education? And what is it they're willing to allow to be collected and processed about them and about their children? And as soon as you say about your children, everything changes. But we have to have that conversation, otherwise we'll never get the benefits. So that's your red line. Do you want me to do the standards now, or shall I wait?
Let's talk first about the red lines of the privacy, and then we can take it to the harder. I think it's the other one is the harder, which about mitigating the inequalities. What do you think? I think all of you need to hold the microphone as your
friend. So one thing which is the big problem with what you about like a the difference between Newton, as you explained, and the and deep learning is with the Newton, I can explain why the sun should rise tomorrow. It's clear there's an equation and the equations are clear. I can run the math and it will give me the exact position of the sun relative to the earth tomorrow at 8 o'clock in the morning. Now, this is one thing. With deep learning, I give it a query, for example, a picture, and it would give me it's 8 or it's a cat. One of the things which is we find it very hard is how to explain or how this machine get the answer cat or 8. And this is one of the difficulties in order to explain the results or analyzing, which creates somehow a need kind of maybe we can use machine learning as a one face in terms or part of a big system that should be kind of more combined in something which is smarter. In education, I think one of the things which is, you know, several years ago, at least in Israel, they were teaching math for elementary school in one kind of method. And then after several years, they tell, oh, this was really wrong. Let us start again from something. And every several years, we get something like this. The issue which is maybe kind of some methodology will be good for one student, or some methodology will be good for many students. So I think if we get students to able to monitor and track the way they solve problems through multiple kind of cases, we'll be able to create multiple pattern that the machine, smart machine, can learn. And then it will, for me, for example, after a while, it will know that this pattern is good for me. For me, it's maybe good to learn, for example, geometry, then go into differential geometry. Or maybe not. This is one of the things which is how these kind of paths of learning should go to help me to learn better. It also will be able to maybe evaluate my reaction. For some example, the time it takes me to learn or to solve problem, or the time my reaction in a class will maybe tell the teacher that I don't understand anything. This is even without the teacher paying attention to all of us.
I'm going to be a troublemaker. You are circumventing the question of the red lines and privacy. What are the red lines? Or do you have any red lines? I mean, you're working with manuscripts, so it's much more easier. But the question, I think David wants to talk.
because we gather information about people.
So go ahead.
Really the problem of red lines is very actual for us. I would say that we have two goals. One goal is to let people know about the information that we gather, and second is to, as much as possible, give people control about this information. Now, it's a goal, it's not a red line. What do I mean? I mean that it's really a struggle, right? Because in most cases, if I give you just a definition of what I'm gathering, usually you would say, okay, it's okay, it sounds good, until you see the information, and then you begin to be worried, right? So you say, oh, it's okay that Google Maps knows where I am, right? And then you look in, and you know, in the history, and you discover that they know all the places where you've been in the past 10 years, and you understand that it's really frightening. So again, it's a goal, how to explain that in the right way. And also, the second thing is about giving people control, because it's very, very difficult, because you, from one side, give to build systems that are usable, those that needs to know about a lot about you and be very personalized. And on the other hand, if you decide to delete a part of your history, then the system will misbehave and you won't be happy. So, I mean, it's a daily struggle, and I think that, as Rose said, it's something that we should keep the discussion going about, and we are going to have this struggle really a lot in the future years, and it should be, you know, something that is public at least.
Which you want to give? Go ahead.
Yeah, I just have a problem with the notion of red line. So if I were to
ask, I can transfer it to a gray line if you want, if it's better.
It's the line part, not the color.
It's the line part, yes.
So if I were to ask, what's the red line for personal privacy, not data privacy, but the social privacy before computers, and the answer would be, well, I don't know, what culture are you in, what's the situation, who are you? Some people don't like they're embarrassed if they're seen without their shoes, some people aren't okay in shorts. In some environments, if I read over your shoulder on a subway, I'm reading your newspaper, I can get a dirty look because I'm invading your privacy. There is no such thing as a red line or gray line for human beings when it comes to privacy. There's this enormously complex, unresolvable set of norms and expectations that are negotiated every time we step into an elevator and we decide, can I talk to someone? In the U.S., you can't. You're not allowed to talk in an elevator, but you can negotiate.
But you can have 50 Shades of Grey, not the book, of course.
So I think it's very much the same question, but worse, because we don't have intuitions about data privacy, and we're just going to have to muddle through it, and we're going to have to keep in mind, because I'm going to very quickly address your second question, I think, a little bit, which
yes,
is
please.
That the data that we collect is always political. That we are making and will reflect our biases, as many people now are saying. The data will reflect our biases even as we are trying to use the data in order to eliminate biases. We have to be very careful about that. And Kathy O'Neill has a book out called Weapons of Math Destruction, which is a very readable explanation of this.
So it's great that you're saying the data is political, because I'm totally with you. I think technology is political, and I think data is political. But then don't we have a responsibility as educators, as researchers, as people who develop those machines and those systems to make sure that we minimize the political facets and the political characteristics of the way that the system is built. And just to make it more complex with the 50 Shades of Grey, when it's political, people have to understand that means that the system can impact our decision, it can impact our behavior, it can change the agenda, the public agenda that we are talking about, and it can change also our norms and our values. So that's something to bear. And the question is, do we have a responsibility? And we can get back to the old question of like whether AI really mitigates and minimizes inequalities, or whether it actually creates certain kinds of inequalities that exist. Go ahead, sorry. It was a long question.
I'll get back to the question of privacy first. I think the issue of, you know, nowadays it's actually all about data. This is kind of the idea, but we can maybe, there is a lot of development in kind of privacy and the encryption in order to prevent our data. But there is a lot of things which is, maybe we need to compromise somehow in order to improve our well-being. For example, nowadays, there is a lot of research that eventually will be able to kind of, will be kind of, you will get kind of medicine which is exactly matches your body or your history, you will be able, from the records of like people, we will be able to get a lot of information about how to treat people better. Do we want to use it or not? Do you want to get, for example, something which is your, for example, voice recognition machine? You want it to work better or you don't care?
So
it's
what do
you
do?
Pay for what you get.
I'm going to give you an example. Can I, Rosa, just a second? Let's say that voice recognition is really important, and let's say that we collect right now the voice recognition of all the people that are in this room. They would probably give their voice recognition, right? And nobody has a problem with that. Of course you do, but whatever. Let's say that we do collect that, and you tell them, I'm doing XYZ with your voice right now. The problem is, and this is biometric data voice recognition, the problem is that certain actors, social actors, can do other stuff with this. And the truth is that, as David was saying in his talk, we don't know a lot of the ways that we're going to use artificial intelligence in the future. We are learning all the time. It's an amazing, the state of deep learning, the state of artificial intelligence now is not where we were 10 years ago. So going back to what David was saying, in a way, we are all the time struggling with explaining the user for something that is changing all the time for us, which makes it. So yes, obviously you have benefits. But the question, if you told a person what would be the downside of it, and you give him the possibility of exempting himself or herself, but you don't know exactly what you're exempting from because you don't know how you would use it in 2 days. Just something to think about. I mean, I'm the troublemaker here. I'm the provocateur here.
I'm not, don't take me. I'm in this issue. I'm naive. I'm kind of really optimile lo takana. So
optimile lo takana is optimist without any exceptions.
I think we
go
do
ahead, Rose.
We definitely have a responsibility, particularly I think as educators, we have a responsibility to make sure that people do get to understand the possibilities. And it's interesting how this discussion has kind of veered into the technical bit again about the data and the machine learning. Let's come back to what it is we're doing this for, because that's where the conversation needs to be. And that's what needs to drive it. And then we look at where it's not going to be hard red lines, I agree. The key thing is that it's a negotiation between the person whose data it is and the people who want to use that data. I mean, this is a really important issue. There isn't a market for personal data in the overt way at the moment, though there is, of course, in terms of it being sold by companies. But as me selling my data and benefiting from it, that's not so much the case. Now, that's going to come. And if we're not careful, that is one of the things that will prolong the elite privileged, because they will know how to sell their data. Whereas other people who don't understand it will have their data sold for them and profited from. So yes, there is a responsibility and there is a politics. In terms of the standardization of what we do, again, that's really important. Because we don't want to recreate the same system that we have now with all its inequalities. And that, again, comes down to what it is you ask of the data and why you're collecting it. Now, we could just redo the same kind of assessment but using big data and AI and just have a more fine-grained version of continual assessment, but it's just along the same subject line standardized before.
And be aware who's excluded and who's included.
Exactly. Now, that's problematic, I agree. And it's not the way I would want us to go, which is why we have to open up a debate about what other things we want to value. But even with that, you would be able to identify resilience, coping with a challenge, trying again and again and again to solve something. Now, those things are valuable. So even in that, in my view, worst-case scenario, there will be other things that we can get from that. It's not the way I'd like to see us go, but I think it's something we can still work with. But we have to open up the debate so that we are starting from a place where we're identifying the sorts of things we want to find in the data and then letting people negotiate and find things for themselves. Maybe the key skill in the future is being able to find new things in your data. That would be great.
I'm giving some signals on the back of my hand. They're not artificial intelligence. It's real people saying, okay, time limited. I would like, before finishing the panel, which is a fascinating panel, we could have debated, it's just the beginning of the debate, actually, to give each one of you the option of saying, you know, a line or two or three, a kind of a conclusion remarks, if you would. I'm looking at you, David, but you didn't prepare, but...
I would like to say maybe one point that we didn't talk about is the role of the regulators. I mean, it's not like there is in this equation only companies and individuals. I mean, we are part of a society, and there are regulations, there are legislations, etc. And there is a big role to legislators to understand what are the issues and to help the public and the companies, you know, to find the right ways, for example, to deal with data. If we take the example with Google and the and the ability, you know, in the EU for people to delete information, for example, from search indices. It's a very important legislation. So I think that there is a big role also for regulators in the market. Just for a concluding remark, I think that, you know, we are really just at the beginning of a new era. I'm not sure we understand how much it is true, and there are very, very exciting opportunities, but every day I see also very big dangers, and I think that this open debate should be something that happens, you know, in the public society, because again, it's not just scientists. Does not have, usually, you know, just mathematicians don't have the tools, I think, to understand, you know, all the conclusions of what they do. So I think this kind of discussions between philosophers, practitioners, maybe legislators, and technologists is very, very important.
Jihad.
Thank you. I still think it's very important to collect data, how we behave or how we solve problems in various levels, and to allow the machines to be able to maybe kind of collect information about the better ways to solve problem or to tackle them, and to create patterns that vary according to our ability and our kind of a ability to maybe to work hard and repeat the same question again and again, try to solve the problem. It's maybe, I think this is have more advantages than kind of like being afraid kind of to have all our data get open, because I think most of the people now put more data in their Facebook than they should. And maybe it's everything. There is always somehow danger in anything. Even if we take the probability of going get hit by a car or die in a car accident, that means maybe we all should stay at home and do nothing. I believe that we should do and take the challenge and take the risk with it while understand what the risk we are doing.
Optimist without exceptions. David.
Which we really, really need, so thank you. We are in a time of enormous contradiction, a sort of Hegelian sort of contradiction that cannot maintain itself. So we've invented a technology that is liberating beyond, liberating of knowledge, of human aspiration, of the ability of people who formerly were left out and left behind to have a voice and to do more and to learn more, and more freedom, more ability to connect directly. And at the same time, we have a system that does this by providing a perfect surveillance system, a perfect system of control, because, well, for reasons you know. This is, and both sides are pushing. I'm from the US, and yesterday my government decided that all of your browsing history can be sold by your access provider to anybody who wants it. This was voted on by the Republican Senate and passed.
David, you don't want to start a new panel, right?
So a lot of people deleting their browser history, even a lot of Americans, even as I sit here. So enormous contradiction, and it is not supportable. And on the one hand, I want to say, so it's up to us to take your point extremely seriously, that it's up to us to decide what we want and to control the technology and our lust for technology, which I certainly share, to serve those ends. But another part of me wants to say, yes, we absolutely should do that, but ultimately, it's not going to be up to us. Forces are loose that are going to resolve themselves. Neither side is going to win. Something else will happen. I don't know.
Rose, final remarks.
Okay, final remark. I think we've got to value human intelligence more explicitly and stop focusing our human education systems on making sure people can do the things that machines are already able to do and maybe can do better, like routine cognitive skills and knowledge. So we need to focus more on that human intelligence and how it's different. And then we need to use that human intelligence to debate how we're going to open up the system, what it is we want to value, where the ethical issues are, and how we protect people. And then we've got to stop empty rhetoric and actually identify how we address that equality issue, make it explicit in what it is that we do say we want to identify in all this big data using AI.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to all the panelists. Thank you. And it's just the beginning of a debate. Thank you, everyone. Ellie, do I call you for the podium?
Well, thank you so much. You have the question there, remember? It was hours ago. You have another 56